I move that the Statutes Amendment Bill 2009 be now read a second time. As the House will be aware, the Statutes Amendment Bill is a useful vehicle for making minor technical and non-controversial amendments to Acts. It allows amendments to be made that would not usually receive sufficient priority to be progressed. Although generally on an annual cycle, the current bill is a combination of the bills developed in 2008 and 2009 and is therefore larger than normal. The bill amends 47 statutes administered by 15 different government agencies and contains 196 members, 196 clauses in total. Each of these amendments in the bill has received unanimous cross-party support, and I thank Parakura Horomia and his team for that. The bill was reported back to by the Government Administration Committee on 1st of April 2010. I thank the committee for its careful consideration of the bill. I endorse the committee's one recommended amendment to clause 1562 of the bill, which I know that Jackie Dean worked on. The amendment will add the words "in each place where it appears," end quote, to the end of the clause, as the term to be replaced by the bill appears more than once in the affected section. This change will be addressed by way of supplementary order paper at the Committee of the Whole House stage, as the committee considered the six additional words did not justify the expense of reprinting the bill at this point. Somewhat unusually for a statutes amendment bill, the bill received five submissions from members of the public. Four of these submissions related to the amendment in clause 119 of the bill. Clause 119, members will be interested to know, to amend section 94A of the Protection of Personal and Property Rights Act 1998, is important. Currently, two people, such as a husband and wife, who wish to create enduring powers of attorney in favour of each other, are required to seek advice and their signatures witnessed by a person who is independent and who is a lawyer, qualified legal executive or authorised trustee corporation officer. In effect, this has meant that two people wishing to create enduring powers of attorney in favour of each other had to seek advice from two different law firms or trustee corporations. This unintended consequence of Section 94A has increased the expense involved and deterred some couples from creating mutual enduring powers of attorney. The amendment will enable witnesses from the same law firm or trustee corporation to separately advise and witness the signatures of two people who are granting each other a respective power of attorney, although each witness must otherwise be independent under Section 94A 4. While the four submitters either supported the intention of the amendment or did not oppose it, they each considered it did not go far enough to address their concerns with the independence requirements of Section 94A. However, any change to widen the amendment in Clause 119 to address the concerns raised would represent a significant policy change, as Parliament has deliberately enacted the requirements for independent witnesses. This is not something that is not suitable to be progressed in a statutes amendment bill. This is not something that is suitable to be progressed in the statutes amendment bill. The committee has recommended that concerns with Section 94A be addressed in the review of the Protection of Personal and Property Rights Act 1988, which is set for 2013 in that piece of legislation. During consideration of the bill by the committee, I signalled that I had received additional amendments for inclusion of the bill, and by I, of course, I mean the Honourable Nathan Guy, subject, of course, to the agreement of all parliamentary parties. All parties have indicated support for an amendment to the Sentencing Act 2002 to correct an error in the definition of, quote, instrument of crime. It is intended that this definition be amended so that it is consistent with the equivalent definition in the Criminal Proceeds Recovery Act 2009. The inconsistent definitions were inserted by the Criminal Proceeds Recovery Bill, which was passed last April and came into effect on 1st of December 2009. The definition was intended to be the same as the definition in the Criminal Proceeds Recovery Act, so that the instruments of crime restrained under the Act could eventually be confiscated under the Sentencing Act. However, a paragraph was omitted in error. The effect is that where an instrument is sold or converted into another property before a forfeiture order is made, the proceeds of property into which the instrument was not converted can be restrained but not confiscated. As with the amendment recommended by the Select Committee, This amendment will be a move by the way of a supplementary order paper at the Committee of the Whole House stage. Mr. Speaker, this bill proposes a number of positive changes to the statute book that are minor, technical or non-controversial. Again, I thank the committee for its diligent and expeditious work, and I commend the bill to the House. Expeditious work, and I commend the bill to the House.
Order. The question is that the motion be agreed to. The Honourable Steve Chadwick.
Well, I'm pleased to take a call on the second reading of this.